Greetings, I'm Mr. Spiffy, and welcome to the bottom of the barrel. Apologize for the lateness of this film, but considering the thin walls are in this new apartment, when I finished up the pay-per-view last night at over, it was around 10:30, I figured it was probably a little too late to go ahead and do my review and give my thoughts on it, because voices carry, and I've got a voice that booms. So, last night was the quote-unquote greatest money in the bank of all time. Well, the question is, was it really that? And without summing up already in advance, I gotta say the answer is no. While it was definitely a good Money in the Bank pay-per-view, there was a lot of stuff on there that was just straight up average. And I'm gonna give you my rundown on it and my thoughts on it. So, we opened up the kickoff show with the Golden Truth versus Breezango. Now, you know, I honestly thought that this match was gonna be mildly entertaining, but wasn't gonna be that much. I didn't know about the little angle that they ran during the Raw pre-show with the tanning beds and the other stuff like that. The makeup job that they did with the over-sunburn and the peeling and everything was great. And it was hilarious. They handled it really well. In the end, Goldust and R-Truth wound up picking up their first win as a tag team over top. Breezango after a lot of matches they've had. Now, for a match that's been, you know, we've had it several times on TV, and not only that, but we've established that these guys are not really, you know, even mid-card at this moment in time. This was a very entertaining matchup. I rather enjoyed it. I gave it a B-, and maybe I'm being a bit too, you know, credible for it. It's just one of those things I was like, I wasn't expecting to go this route, so it entertained me. The Lucha Dragons versus the Dudley Boys. It was there. The Dragons won. Let's move on. It was a C match. It was average. Tag title matchup. Enzo and Cass versus the Vaudevillains versus the Club versus the New Day. Fast-paced match. Well thought out. Honestly, tag team Fatal 4-Ways are always a little weird for me because I always felt that maybe they should have one member of each team in there at all times, so it should really always be in Fatal 4-Way rules. And honestly, there were times where it's like the ref couldn't keep track of who was legal. It just broke down early on, and that's what you expected to happen. So, in the end, the New Day managed to pick up a win. There were definitely some miscues, like when Big E picked up Carl Anderson onto his shoulders, and he just stood there and waited and waited and waited and waited, staring down Luke Gallows. Luke Gallows doing nothing. Why? Because Big Cass was out of position when he was supposed to nail Luke Gallows and get him out of there. In the end, the New Day pick up the win. Another odd thing about this matchup was they announced Luke Gallows and Carl Anderson a total combined weight of 404 pounds. Now, I know for a fact that at least by himself, Luke Gallows is like 260, 270. So, are they saying that Carl Anderson's only a buck and change? I think, honestly, Lillian Garcia fucked up on that one. C-plus for that matchup. We go backstage to an interview with Kevin Owens. Chris Jericho gets involved, and then Alberto Del Rio gets involved. Del Rio was pretty much there to be the foil for these guys, to be someone to be picked on. Kevin Owens and Chris Jericho were brilliant, as always, on the microphone, back and forth. Kevin Owens especially, just a lot of entertaining stuff in there. I wish I could say what, there was one part that really stood out for me, but it didn't. There wasn't like a memorable line or anything, but certainly they were definitely enjoyable to watch together. Baron Corbin versus Dolph Ziggler, number 273. The audience wasn't into this matchup. The audience straight up shat on this matchup during parts of it. There were chants that were boring. They were a chance of let's go Ziggler, Ziggler sucks, and not only that, but it was just half-hearted. There was a point where the referee had to, it was either referee or Ziggler, had to tell Baron Corbin, hit your pose! You know, it was just, it wasn't a very good matchup. I mean, it wasn't bad, there was nothing technically wrong with it. Just the audience couldn't give a shit and neither could I. Score for that one was a C, Baron Corbin picks up the win. I'm hoping that this feud is over. With little to no fanfare, out comes the women's matchup, Charlotte and Dana Brooke versus Becky Lynch and Natalya. Another bland, average match. This wasn't all that spectacular. Dana Brooke still looks green as goose shit in there, despite the fact she's on the main roster. In comparison to the other three women in the ring, she doesn't look like she knows what she's doing, and it's really stinking out the joint. The match itself, I gave it a C. The best part of the matchup actually was came after the matchup when Natalya, surprisingly, I thought Natalya was doing another one of their, oh, I'm crying again, because women have to cry when they're upset. That's all they ever do, apparently, according to WWE. Their immediate response to losing is, so, Natalya going from tears to, I'm gonna throw you all over Becky Lynch was entertaining and surprising. So, I guess Natty's going heel. I don't know what they're doing with Charlotte next with her and Dana Brooke, but Charlotte and Dana Brooke won that matchup. As I said, I gave the match a C. Sheamus versus Apollo Crews. I wanted this match to be better than it was. Not to say that it was terrible. Certainly both men pulled out quite a few number of maneuvers to really try to impress. I felt that the Apollo Crews' moonsault to the outside was great. Now, I don't know if anybody else noticed this, but there was a guy in the second row. The only reason why you could see him so clearly was because he had a little girl sitting in front of him. And is it just me, or did he fall asleep during this matchup? His eyes were closed, he wasn't moving, he was just... I'm fairly sure that he dozed off. Whoever he was, yeah, this match did absolutely nothing for him, apparently. He did wake up towards the end there. Apollo Crews picks up the win with a cradle from a crucifix position. And actually, a well done after a pretty nice looking white noise off of the middle rope. So, something we haven't seen Sheamus do before. I can appreciate that. C+ for the matchup. It could have been better. But I don't think it was a disappointing match overall. AJ Styles versus John Cena. Once in a life. Oh, wait, no, wrong, sorry. The match we waited on for 15 years, or really, honestly, maybe only about 10, because really AJ Styles was only big when TNA was big, but whatever. Well, it is all semantics. This one was a real choice styling of showing how two veterans work a matchup and can still keep a crowd. Neither of these men took any serious bumps. Or outside of, I think, that one back body drop AJ took where he landed on his tailbone instead of on his, instead of doing the proper flat bump. These two guys really went out there and kept the audience engaged, did a lot of back and forth, decent wrestling, and really did nothing to put themselves in any danger, considering that both men, one man's coming off of an injury and the other man had been nursing a partially injured, I think it was AJ said his ankle. So both men went out there and worked a slower paced, smarter matchup, and it still was really good. In the end, AJ Styles picks up the win thanks to outside interference by the club when the referee gets knocked down. JBL decides he's going to turn face at this moment and go, "No! We were robbed! This was horrible! This screwed over AJ! This screwed over Cena! This screwed over the fans! Everybody got fucked! We're all fucked! We're fucked! We're fucked! We're fucked!" He's doing his best impersonation of us here in the IWC, I suppose. No, JBL. This was an expected outcome. This was not, we were screwed out of a surefire victory. Nobody expected AJ Styles to beat John Cena clean. If you did, you're deluding yourself. Now, AJ Styles has the capabilities of, and I'm going clean, and I'm sure that Cena would allow him to, but the angle and the way they ran it and everything that was said, it screamed that the club was going to get involved. When you have a contract sign that says the club will not be at ringside, we know the club is going to fucking show up to ringside. So JBL, get your head out of your ass and stop trying to be self-righteous. It doesn't work for you. My opinion on this match was I really enjoyed it, and I gave it an A-. The Money in the Bank ladder matchup. Not a lot of scary high spots, but definitely a matchup where they used the ladders very well and very innovatively. I especially enjoyed the part where all six men were on the string of ladders ringing from one end of the post to the next end of the post. Overall, I really liked this matchup. There was a lot of close calls, a lot of close feels. I also gave this match an A-. I happen to really, really enjoy it. Dean Ambrose picking up the win, and I noticed he didn't take a lot of hits and bumps, and it just rang towards him becoming WWE Champion at the end of the night. Spoilers. But if you're watching this, what the fuck are you talking to me for anyway? And you know about spoilers. U.S. title match, which I completely forgot was on the card. Rusev versus Titus O'Neil. Rusev spent most of the time using taunting Titus's sons at ringside. In the end, Titus taps out to the accolade. I expected more out of this match. I actually expected Titus to win it, but apparently they're going for a much stronger push for Rusev, so kudos for him. He deserves being back up on top as well. Rusev, still the United States champion. I gave the match a C+. It wasn't bad. It wasn't spectacular either. WWE Championship, Seth Rollins versus Roman Reigns. These guys really did try out there. Romans, of course, got shit on during it with the You Can't Wrestle chants, and Roman sucks, and it was obvious that the audience was not going to get behind him. The audience was behind Rollins. Rollins reversing the spear into a modified pedigree was nicely done. I don't think I've ever seen anybody do that. It's possible Triple H might have on somebody else, but I don't recall it. There's a lot of just really good spots. Of course, you know, the Spanish announce table gets broken, which JBL immediately says, yeah, right table, and then, of course, and they start going after the American table. Seth Rollins, in the end, hits the pedigree on Roman Reigns one more time, 1, 2, 3, and we have a new WWE champion. A surprising outcome. I actually expected Roman to retain the title, or have this match turn into a triple threat, again, much like WrestleMania. Instead, Rollins picks up the win, and here comes Ambrose. Oh, and by the way, that match was a B. Ambrose hits, Ambrose's music hits, Rollins is waiting, like, oh, he's gonna attack him from behind. Boom. Does attack him from behind with the briefcase, knocks him flat, calls for the cash-in, gets him there, bell rings after Rollins manages to get back to his feet, because again, I guess they decided now that the wrestler has to respond again, you know? They keep changing that rule every single time. Sometimes when the guy cashes in, the wrestler has to respond. Other times when he cashes in, just ring the bell and pin him, i.e. Daniel Bryan over the Big Show. It's one of those things that's like, they just sort of arbitrarily decide how they're going to do it, and that's the way it goes. In the end, you've got Ambrose hitting Dirty Deeds on Seth Rollins. 1, 2, 3, Dean Ambrose is your new WWE champion. I don't normally give ranks to cash-ins, but I enjoyed it, and I thought the ebb and flow was decent, and of course it was short. I also gave that a B. Final score for the greatest Money in the Bank ever is a B. And while I could say that it definitely ranks up there as one of the top Money in the Bank events, at least for the main event matches did deliver in the way they were supposed to, a lot of this card was exceptionally average. I mean, it was nothing that we couldn't have seen on Monday Night Raw. There wasn't anything there that just screamed, hey, this is an amazing pay-per-view. The matches that screamed that did it very well. In the end, I think they went out there and did a decent job. I think I still enjoyed Money in the Bank 2011 in Chicago better. Of course, I have the unique distinction of not necessarily being there live, but I went and saw it at a sports bar in Los Angeles. So that was a point where I met a former Tough Enough guy who was there watching it. I hung around with a lot of wrestling fans. There was a lot of energy there. And when you have that kind of energy, of course, it's always going to blind you a little bit. But I have to go off of how I remember. The only way I could compare it would be if I were to go back and watch the event again and rank it. Which, maybe at some point, I'll do much like I'm doing with my Surviving Survivor Series and my Mania Week Series, is and go back and rewatch all the Money in the Banks. Speaking of which, next week on Surviving Survivor Series with the 1995 Survivor Series, and I'm only a couple weeks away from having to start doing a Royal Rumble one, and I haven't quite come up with a name for the show yet. If you guys have any suggestions for a weekly Royal Rumble show, shoot it to me. I've already thought of one such as Road to Rumble, Ready to Rumble, Rumble Road, Royal Rumblings, some of the ones I've come up with. I haven't quite found one that I feel just rolls off the tongue. If you've got any suggestions, or if you want to thumbs up one of the ones I just said, feel free, let me know. I'm Mr. Spiffy, this barrel's been scraped clean. As always, please like, share, subscribe, and comment. I always appreciate all your feedback, and let me know what you thought about the Money in the Bank pay-per-view. Do you think it was the greatest Money in the Bank ever? Alright, I'll catch you guys later. It's almost time for Monday Night Raw. Bye.